I'm Claudia Bester. I'm the Director of Public Programs, and I'm delighted to welcome you all to the Hammer conversation tonight with Arthur Jafa and Greg Tate. Tonight's talk is in conjunction with the Hammer Museum's biennial called Made in L.A., Only. Now on to tonight's conversation. Arthur Jafa was born in Tupelo, Mississippi, and is best known for his work as a director and cinematographer, working on films such as Crooklyn, Seven Songs for Malcolm X, and Daughters of the Dust. He also directed the films Deschotten 1.0, Tree, and Slowly This. In addition to his work on films, Jafa's also published essays on black cultural politics in the books Black Popular Culture and Everything But the Burden, What White People are Taking from Black Culture. Jafa studied at Howard University in D.C., and his work has been shown at the Whitney, Media City in Seoul, Black Box at the Wattis Institute in Oakland, Artist Space in New York, Tramway in Glasgow, and at the Vancouver Art Gallery. In the Hammer's Made in L.A. exhibition, we have a room with vitrines which display Arthur Jafa's mixed media collage lookbooks that he created while working on films during the last 15 years. These visual notebooks have served as the place where Jafa has been able to work out his theory about a black aesthetic. As the exhibition co-curator Hamza Walker put it, Jafa has been seeking a model for black cultural production that revolves around the relationship of pain and beauty. And if we have that wrong, Arthur, you can correct us later. That model for black cultural production is always music. Music is a form of production and a form of expression that is fully realized and fully crystallized, and Jafa is seeking to draw parallels between that very model, a very successful model, and what that would look like in visual arts such as film. What would a black cinema look like? So those notebooks are a place where he works on figuring that out. Greg Tate was a staff writer at the Village Voice from 1987 to 2005. His writings on culture and politics have been published in the New York Times, the Washington Post, Art Forum, Vibe, and Rolling Stone. From 2011 to 2015, he was a visiting professor at Brown, where he taught the Africana Studies course, The History of Afrofuturism and Black Science Fiction. He also taught at Williams College, Columbia University, and at Yale University's graduate art program. His books include the aforementioned Everything But the Burden, What White People Are Taking from Black Culture, Midnight Lightning, Jimi Hendrix and the Black Experience, Flyboy and the Buttermilk, Essays on American Culture, and Brooklyn Kings, New York's Biker Gangs, with photographer Martin Dixon. And this fall, Duke University Press will publish his new book, Flyboy 2, The Greg Tate Reader. Since 1999, Tate has led the umpteen-member conducted improvisation ensemble, Burnt Sugar, the Orchestra Chamber. The group deploys Butch Moritz's patented conduction system and performs regularly in Europe, Canada, and the United States, and they've released 15 albums on the label Avant-Groid. Arthur Jafa and Greg Tate have been talking about their ideas and theories of a black aesthetic over the course of a very long friendship. They're both very interested in culture, visual art, music, and film, but music is ultimately the lingua franca they use most often. So tonight, we get to hear what they talk about and how these ideas are manifested in their own work. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Arthur Jafa and Greg Tate.
Yeah. Welcome, family. Thanks for coming out. And Jay, I'm just going to jump right into it. Because one of the ways I think about you, or at the core of what I think about in terms of your work, your practice, you know, and the many hats you wear, you know, theorist, technician, filmmaker, visual artist, so forth and so on and so forth, dad. but at the core, I think of you as an oral Southern storyteller, you know, and the thing is, folks who know you over the years have, can recall these epic sessions where you basically talk out like a 2-3-4 hour film in detail, graphic detail. And but it also extends to films you've seen, because I'll never forget, we were telling our friend Peck T about the film Alien, and you basically acted out the whole film for her. And she said, I don't even need to see it now. And it was true, you know. So I was thinking, just to give folks a sample of what I'm talking about in terms of that oral Southern basis to your storytelling, If you would tell one of those tales from back home that you shared with me over the years, it could be one I haven't heard, you know. But of course, you know,
you've heard all
the
of
favorite,
them.
There's the greasy man, of course.
I can tell the greasy man.
You can tell, you know. But I like, you know, but there's the one that your dad told you about, them lynching the white man or in Mississippi, or chasing the white man, you know, who rolled up on him, you know. So, you know, but I know you've got a vast repertoire.
I feel like I'm to on, choose the, on NPR or something.
Yeah, totally. This is live.
Well, I mean... I'm gonna have to refute. I'll tell a version of a story. It's like, well, first of all, I just want to say just one thing. Claudia's introduction, she mentioned some films that I've done or worked on, but one film in particular, which is a really important film to me, she mentioned, was Deshadin. But that film was co-directed by myself and my good partner, ace friend, Malik Saeed. So I didn't get a chance to look at it before. But yeah, you know. I think that, I grew up in the Delta. I mean, just to give people, I guess, as a segue into a story of sorts. I grew up in the Mississippi Delta. I was born in Tupelo, Mississippi, which is in Mississippi, obviously, but it's not in the Delta. And it's a very interesting two places to grow up in, because I sort of grew up in both places simultaneously. My extended family, you know, from Tupelo, Brooksville, around Tupelo, Lee County, when I was in the, in about 67 to 68, when I was in the second grade, I think, my parents moved to Clarksdale, Mississippi, which sometimes people refer to as the capital of the Delta. And for all of my teenage years, we went back and forth between Tupelo and Clarksdale. And see, the thing about that is, they were only about 2.5 hours apart, but the environments couldn't have been more different. I mean, Tupelo was, some people have heard this already, but Tupelo was a model post-integrated southern town for a lot of very, very interesting and specific reasons. But and Clarksdale was not. Clarksdale was segregated in the kind of, you know, maybe not legally at that point, but in every other sense, it was a segregated environment. You know, there was two of everything. When the high school was integrated, the public high school was integrated in Clarksdale, then Lee Academy opened, which is a pattern you saw in a lot of towns in the South. But I like to think that my personality was very much shaped by the going back and forth between those two places on a weekly basis. And what it did was it produced, I think, a kind of alienation in both places. You know what I mean? So when I was in Tupelo, I didn't buy into this. I was very cynical about this vision of post-racial or post-whatever segregated Mississippi. And when I was in Clarksdale, I was very acutely aware of the sort of deprivations and limitations of that particular environment, because on a weekly basis, I would see my cousins participating in Little League baseball and basketball with, you know, a large community, a lot of resources and things like that. And when I came back to Clarksdale, it was just the opposite. So, but Clarksdale, which is a place I spent the first part of my life trying to get out of. I was really sort of determined to get out of there. And but it was a place that, as I went to Howard University, I started to realize had a lot of... maybe even mythic kind of dimensions and stuff. And as I got to be an adult, and I ended up after a few years in LA, a few years in Atlanta, I ended up in New York, I guess at about 28. And I did find myself in many instances being in positions where I would be telling people these various things about Mississippi, which, you know, people I think thought I was making these things up. I used to say that the Delta in particular is like the Afro-American Jurassic Park, you know, in terms of just the culture. And, you know, I used to say the culture is like dinosaurs. There's all this wild stuff going on. Like, for example, as Greg mentioned, when I was in about the seventh or eighth grade, there was a period in Cahoma County, which is where Clarksdale was, where the whole county was terrorized by this guy who was referred to as the Greasy Man. And essentially, who the greasy man was this guy who basically would cover his entire body in Vaseline, like nude. He would cover his entire body in Vaseline, and he would sneak into people's houses. And he wouldn't do anything. He wouldn't, you know, assault people or anything like that. He would just basically go and sit in their furniture. So basically what would happen is, like, in most instances, people wouldn't even know that they had been visited by the greasy man until they sat on the couch or something, and there was this deep oil stain on the couch or something like this, right? And that was a good year or two period. I was like, lock your doors, lock your windows, because the greasy man is out. You know? It's really interesting because, ironically, my favorite high school teacher, Mrs. McBride, she actually was involved in the capture of the greasy man, because when she was a senior in high school, she woke up in the middle of the night, went to use the bathroom, and saw this black man with no clothes on, completely covered in Vaseline, sitting in her parents' living room, you know, and very quietly went and got her father and her brother, and they basically tackled him. Now, there have been several instances where people have woke up and seen the greasy man, but for the obvious reasons, they could never tackle him. He would get away, you know. And it turned out it was a very successful black lawyer, if I remember correctly, who was schizo or something, right? Ended up in Whitfield, which is the Delta equivalent of, like, Bellevue, I guess, in New York. So anyway, I've always wanted to make some films about some of this stuff. Oh, and they go on and on. The Rock Baby, I could tell you a lot of different ones. But anyway, I don't know what purpose that served.
Just to set the stage, you know.
Yeah.
You know. But I also would like you to just talk about coming up in Tupelo in this, I don't know if I call it proto or kind of pre-post civil rights moment, you know, because you kind of traversed the 60s into the 70s there. But, you know, that's also where you really started to develop a very kind of broad and eclectic vocabulary in terms of music, in terms of culture, in terms of visual images, you know. And I wonder if you could just talk about the importance of your encounters, you know, with Chaka Khan, say, on the one hand, and David Bowie on the other, you know.
I mean, you know, strangely enough, the music thing, you know, like everybody who's my age, I was born in 1960, everybody who's my age, James Brown was the, you know, that was the context of everything musically for me at that time. I sort of, my dad listened to Ray Charles and things like that, but really it was like the earliest thing I remember musically is James Brown. I remember dancing and doing splits. Go AJ, go Art, go. I did splits, the whole thing. But, you know, like Tupelo seemed to me, besides the fact that it was the birthplace of Elvis Presley, so I was inundated with Elvis Presley from, you know, my earliest consciousness. I think the first song I ever remember is Hound Dog or something like that, because they just, you know, Elvis Presley was in heavy rotation. But besides that, Tupelo always seemed to be a very... you know, deracinated environment, musically speaking, compared to Clarksdale, for a couple of reasons. The radio in Tupelo was, you know, Elvis Presley and some weird mix of Conway Twitty or whatever. But whereas Clarksdale was right beneath Memphis, so you had WDIA, which was one of the, you know, preeminent sort of R&B soul stations in America. I mean, so, and this is a period where you had Al Green and Rufus Thomas and all this stuff coming out of Memphis. So that's what we listened to. And the local radio station in Clarksdale was WROX. And some of my earliest memories are like this DJ Early Wright, you know, with the voice and like, this is Early Wright at, you know, WROX, this kind of stuff. And just the vibe, you know, the vibe of the sounds and stuff. And so what happened, I think, at a certain point, all that stuff sort of permeated the environment, you know? I mean, I guess it's R&B blues aesthetic is what I would call it now. It just permeated the environment. And then at a certain point, because I was reading like Rolling Stone magazine and The Village Voice at a certain point, I became like aware of, you know, like punk rock and stuff like that. You know, I was just reading rock critics who were reading, you know, stuff. So I was always into rock. I think the first record I ever bought was probably Elton John's Goodbye Yellow Brick Road or something like that, you know. And but I associated that in a strange kind of way more with Tupelo, because in some ways you could get those things. Like, you couldn't hardly find that kind of stuff in Clarksdale, you know. I remember seeing the Sex Pistols' first album, and I was literally afraid to buy it. Because if you were reading, I was like, it's going to pollute your mind. You're going to go crazy and stuff. So I remember going to the store in Tupelo and holding it and walking to the, and then putting it back, like, I better not buy that. It's going to ruin my life. And eventually I did, you know, I kind of did buy the Sex Pistols. I bought, like, Talking Heads. This was, like, you know, a really good period, like, for music and stuff. So, you know, it's the same kind of, I mean, at the point, I think I experienced it as a duality, or some kind of split. And to a certain degree in my life, it's always been about trying to drive these things that purportedly are mutually exclusive. I mean, in some ways, like, I'm thinking of like a picture in one of the books. You know, it's interesting, there's a picture, if people have seen the book or not. On one hand, it has Serena Williams, you know, the shot. I used to say, have you seen the shot? People were like, what shot? I was like, well, you haven't seen it. Have you seen the shot? The shot of Serena. And then there's a Japanese Buto dancer next to it. And it's so funny, Hamza, like, you know, really liked that image from the beginning. He kind of selected, and it's funny, I would have never selected that image. But that image, you know, it is pretty iconic of what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Like, you got this thing over here and this thing over there, and they supposedly don't meet. But what you realize at a certain point is where they meet is in you. You know, so I not very quickly, but by the time I hit my late teens, I was already sort of trying to assert the sense that whatever it is I felt, whatever it is I was into, was cool and it was fly. You know what I mean? It was fly. I didn't have to be alienated over here, alienated over there. And then when I hit DC and Howard and everything, it kind of all came together because, you know, Bad Brains and things like that, which you actually saw people who were approximately your age actually manifesting new stuff that sort of took those things as a given. So, you know.
Yeah. Right. Well, I know you want to show some work, and I thought we'd kind of set up the first, because you want to show Apex first, right?
Yeah, we can show Apex.
Yeah, but one of the things that I think that your work stalks or circles around, you know, are what we could identify as the differences between the way we think about what we would call black representation and then the representation of blackness.
Right.
And then there's performance of, you know, one's own blackness in the real world, you know. And I think that in some ways, like a lot of your work, you know, confuses, you know, and confounds and bedazzles because it definitely uses those, it kind of creates an axis where all those things can kind of flow and even disrupt one another as well. So I wonder if you could just talk about, you know, what those terms, how they resonate with you in terms of the work you're doing, black representation, representation of blackness, performance of blackness in the real
world. You know, for a long time, you know, and you've heard this obviously, Greg, for years, like just in terms of my pursuit of film and trying to crystallize or articulate what kinds of ambitions and objectives might be worth pursuing. I used to have this thing I used to say, like, people think, like, radical representation in terms of black people and stuff was going to be like black astronauts, black, you know, black doctors or something like that. But I was like, I had started making a list, as you know, of words that you'd never heard black people say in a movie before, you know? And the first one was always sorbet, you know? Because people always think it's going to be something out, you know what I mean? And not something that, yeah, you don't associate black people with sorbet, but I don't know any black people who have, a black person who hasn't had sorbet, you know what I mean? So to me, it was like, you know, exquisite. Has a black person ever said exquisite in the history of cinema? I mean, maybe at this point, but I can't think of an example. But so a lot of it to me was like that, being very interested in almost kind of uncanny divergence between the complexity and the realness of black people as we know them and the kind of representations that, you know, sort of permeate or saturate the environment. Somebody said to me, I was having a conversation with somebody about the books, you know, and they said, oh yeah, I really love that page where you have Sid Vicious with a certain expression, a certain, you know, body language, and then you have DMX. And then they said, you know, I'm sure in the history of mankind, nobody's ever put Sid Vicious next to DMX, you know? And it seems crazy and outrageous that that might be true, but that in fact might be true. I might be the only person who has ever put Sid Vicious next to DMX. And so what the books in a sense always were, was a space where I could sort of exercise, you know, like this sense that I had that, look, it's more complicated than it's generally presented. You could work out whether these things produce a charge, because I do think they produce a very particular type of charge. And I think the books, in one sense, they were real investigations of what happens when you put these two things where there's almost like an interdiction between those things. These two things shall not come together. It's a kind of miscegenation in a sense. Like, these two things didn't come together, but if you put them together, they produce a certain type of energy. Like, it's very much tied to, you know, a lot of my thinking about the history of, or the trajectory of African and Black aesthetics in the West, you know? And people have heard me talk about this before, but anyway, like I'm very interested in how, like, when African sculpture first hit the West, it has this profound formal impact on Western painting, which is Western image making or picture making. And Picasso and, you know, Braque and Durain, these, all these guys, they see this stuff and it has these intense formal implications for what they're doing. So Western Vanishing Point and all these kinds of things, they see these African sculptures and say, these are figures, like embedded or inscribed in these figures are a different way of seeing figures in the world, meaning like these things are based on seeing something from multiple vantage points. In that sense, it's like a post-Cartesian kind of way of seeing the world, right? So hence you get cubism, like in a sense, like you get cubism. Early on, like with Picasso's first quote unquote great cubist painting, Demoiselle, like one of the things that I even play with in the books is like how he literally painted photos of Black women that he has. So a lot of those images where their arms are and stuff, you see that? That's like literally Picasso painting them. So it's not even just the formal system he was interrogating or trying to work with, it's literally Black bodies. So, but what's really deep to me is how Duchamp, right, who I think was, as I've said, smarter than any of those guys, he quickly, like, he saw it and he made his series of paintings, Nude Descending, you know, the Stairs and stuff, that are about time, space, and all these vanishing stuff like that, those implications. But what he peeped, and I don't think anybody else peeped, was this idea that, well, actually, the real power of these African artifacts in the context that they're in now is not just the formal system that's inscribed in them, but the fact that they're radically alienated from the context that they found themselves in, that it produced a very particular type of energy. And he thought that was way more interesting than just the formal implication. So hence you get things like the urinal. Like, I think the urinal comes directly out of a perception that African artifacts in the Western context, two radically alienated entities, spatial things, create a particular type of energy. So to me, in a sense, the books are very much preoccupied with that. Like, okay, Duchamp realized this, what happens, okay, so as a Black person, a person of African descent, this thing, I'm not just, we're not just talking about objects that were created. I was like, I am an object, the Black body is an object. So I grew up, as I said, going back and forth between these two environments, being hyper-conscious of how I informed the environments that I found myself in, but how those environments also deflected how I understood myself. But it's really about the bringing together of supposedly divergent phenomena and what that produces, particularly when, as an object, Black people were objects when we came here. We also simultaneously, you know, we were things, but we were simultaneously subjects. Mm-hmm. So what happens when you exist in the sense of that space of being dually or equally a thing and a person?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Sure, an alien and an expressionist, man.
Yeah.
But I know that the speech you want to show, Apex, has a point of departure, which is a film project. And I'm not going to put you on the spot and ask you to synopsize it. Just because I know I've seen you do it, it's like a 2-hour telling in and of itself. But I mean, why don't you just give some, you know, a skeletal outline of Apex, and then we can talk about it as also being an animate extension of what's going on in the books.
In the books,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Well, Apex is a science fiction narrative about a band, about a band in the future, and they simultaneously, they create an AI that becomes a member of the band, and the band, they become the biggest band on the face of the earth, right? And what the film is an attempt to do is to follow the trajectory of the band through all of its iterations as it evolves, as the members of the band evolves, as the world is coming to an end. So it's like the whale has collapsed with Nirvana, but the world is coming to an end. So you actually see the kinds of things that accrue around the band, you know, as they sort of evolve. Like one of the key members of the band ends up in this prison called the Grail early in the film. He comes out of the Grail, but when he comes out of the Grail, he's been transformed by this sect called the Drazen. And the Drazen believe two things, Earth first and black being is eternal. And to that end, they have this philosophy that the only way that we can, like the whole idea of reducing the carbon footprint is like enough for them. They want to eliminate the carbon footprint. So they think essentially all human beings have to get into hard drive. So in this sense, that aspect is not new. But the whole idea is like, how we see that come about in the whole, you know, how this band like the Wailers, you know, they're both a pop band, but they're proselytizers for like Rastafarianism. We see this band Apex and how it then becomes conflated with this spontaneously generated godlike being called the Mouse, who's an artificial intelligence, and sort of adopts the band as a kind of Orisha, I guess, for them.
Yeah, so. You can stop right there.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Okay.
Yeah. So in feminist film theory, in black representational theory, there's a lot of conversation about the gaze. And when I look at this work, I see it as a manifestation of your gaze. And what I would also assign as your scopophilia. So, yeah, it's like your obsession with witnessing through imaging, right? And this piece is obviously like an intermediary between the books as work, as sketchbooks, workbooks,
right,
and then this cinema that you want to birth and bring into being. And I wonder if you could just talk about how this assemblage relates to the black cinema you want to see come into being and how it relates to what we might identify as certain absences in our definition of black cinema at present.
Well, I mean, first of all, just in terms of like procedure, I mean, the reason I thought like it was interesting to show Apex was because it sort of, in a sense, this iteration of it, because I've come to understand this as an iteration of it, mm-hmm. even though I have this $150 million version in my head, you know, that looks more like a movie, I guess. But in a sense, its relationship to the books, right, is very specific in the sense that, like, when Hamza and Aram first approached me and said, hey, we're interested, we heard about these books, we want to show these books, I was like, really? I haven't looked at those in about, 6 years. I actually stopped making the books, you know. The impulse to make the books was really, it's really more impulse, as I said, to gather and to collate and to compile these images, right? And in a sense, the orchestration and selecting of the images was really about trying to concretize or manifest things that are absent, but I know they exist, you know, things that I feel, I see. And so I always cut pictures out and make those books and stuff. About 8 or 9 years ago, what happened was the whole, the practice sort of, it sort of migrated to my computer. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just stopped doing the books. You know, I stopped because the books required me to go out, get magazines, cut magazines up, which I did very compulsively for 15 or 16 years, I guess. My father says I always did a version of the books. Even when I was a kid, a child, you know. But in that form that they have now with the binders and stuff, I guess I did that from about 87 to about 2005, maybe. I know this because my son was born in 2004 and I kind of stopped making the books. This is right around the time, you know, internet started happening. I started getting scanners and things like this. So basically it just became much, much easier to just trial the internet, pull those images together and just make these files. So I still compulsively pull images like literally every day. If I'm not doing something really, really specific, I'm pulling images and I put them in these grid. I put them on these grids, right? Now, you know, the cinema thing is funny to me. It's like, I studied architecture at Howard, drifted into cinema, into film. Stopped being involved with film around 97, 98. Became like super disenchanted with film as an industry. You know, industry part of it, not the medium itself. I was very frustrated, couldn't figure out how I was actually going to get into things. You know, I wanted to make made, and just started becoming increasingly interested in something or attempting to do something I'd always been interested in, which was just a function in the fine arts, the art context. And to a certain degree, like if you look at the books, you can see, like when Hamza first looked at the books, you know, I would say extreme things like these books are abortions. You know, like why? You know, I don't know. I don't want to show these things. These things are all about things that I didn't get done. You know, or I would say it's like going to a restaurant to read somebody's cookbook but not eat the food. You know, now I think because I had a certain amount of energy around my inability or to be able to figure out how to navigate the space of manifesting certain kinds of things. I mean, I got a lot of baggage, you know, and a lot of it is directly, you know, bound up with being from Mississippi and stuff like that. You know, I've been told I have some serious authority issues. So I then, you know, did the art thing. And I think to a certain degree, really successful. I mean, like within a year said, I'm going to do the art thing. I was in the biennial and things like this. Now, I very quickly became very uncomfortable with that because I didn't like the touchy-feely relationship between the artists and the collectors and stuff. I'm not, as anybody who knows me, I'm not a touchy-feely kind of person. It just seemed like the collectors wanted to, they buy a thing and then they want to rub you or something. So it has your smell on it or something. It sort of freaked me out at a certain point. I mean, and I'm talking about really nice people. I'm not like saying that people are not nice or anything.
But still consumers.
It's a power, yeah, consumers. And it's a kind of power relationship that I'm uncomfortable with. It's not like them per se, it's just I'm uncomfortable with my own complicity in wanting something, you know, from people. I remember when I first started being invited to these dinners on the Upper East Side. I was living in New York. I've been out here for about 5 or 6 years. And it was just strange to me, you know, like I was like, I just sort of got it in my head that I was making things for rich people's walls, and it just completely shut my practice down, you know, in a lot of ways, you know. And the thing about, even in terms of showing the books, the thing about the books for a long time is they were like a really free space. Like people had really asked me from years ago, want to show the books, want to show the books. And I had just always just completely said, no way, I don't want to do that. And it wasn't so conscious, but it was really because the books are a space where I do what the fuck exactly I want to do. Like I noticed even like in the course of the show, when I had decided that I wanted to make some new books just so the, you know, the books didn't all seem like in the past tense, because I still do, you know, do a version of them. I was going to reverse engineer some of these digital files back into books. And it was really like complicated for me on a psychic level because all of a sudden I was making these books to be shown. You know, I went to about 8 years ago, I went to Italy for a period of time to work with I don't know if people know this theater guy named Giorgio Grotowski and Thomas Rich's work center in Pontedera, Italy. I became like very interested because I was reading about them and they, in terms of the practice, their practice evolved to this place, to this stage right before Grotowski died that he termed artist vehicle. And what artist vehicle was a couple of things, but primarily what it was if you take the classic theatrical equation whereby a writer imagines something, he writes a text, some performers stand on the stage and they act out that text and the audience sees that text, the meaning is made somewhere in between the perception of the audience and how that sort of impacts the performers performing the text, right? So what they did was just completely took the audience out of the equation. Like essentially, they started developing these what they call theatrical performances or opuses that were not designed to be seen by audiences. And they would work on pieces for like 15 years, just developing like 12, 14 hours a day, 5, 6, 7 days a week that were never shown to audiences. Now, I was fascinated by that because it bore some, I think, connection to how I was feeling about the books in the sense that it was a free space for me. So now, and I'm rambling a bit now, I know, but the thing for me, like on the cinema question, like, this is the point I was trying to make. I started off in architecture, went to film, decided I was retiring from film. I started to tell people I'm retired from cinema. Had a bit of an art career, some success, became creeped out by certain aspects of the art world, and decided, okay, film is where I should be. But what I've kind of come to realize is that what I'm really mostly interested in is aesthetics. I'm interested in ideas, you know? And really kind of doesn't matter, because like when I was in architecture, I wouldn't have said it like this at the time, but I, you know, in hindsight, like I know I was struggling to articulate, because I used to say things like, if Kinda Blue was a house, what would it look like? You know, if Electric Ladyland was a house, what would it look like? I just basically lost faith that there was going to be the space for me to actually build the kind of architecture, given that most Black people don't even own their own homes, you know, that people were going to commission me to make this crazy architecture stuff that to me was going to be an attempt to manifest Black aesthetics in architectural terms. Like, and so when I went over to film, my preoccupations were the same preoccupations. So when I went to fine arts, it's the same obsessions. Like, what are the implications of Black being, which is a very specific thing, specific from African aesthetics and stuff, but completely derived and evolved out of African aesthetics. What are the implications of those things in the particular medium or terms that you find yourself operating? So now that I'm, quote unquote, back to film and maybe still potentially dabbling in art stuff, I think the books are more than anything me exercising certain kinds of possibilities. Like, I know you used to say all the time, because there was a period in my life where I didn't go anywhere without a book. I mean, I had them in my backpack. Wherever I went, I was very apt to just whip one out and start showing them to people, you know? And Greg would always say something like, did they see the book or did they get the tour of the book, you know? Because the tour of the book was like flipping through the book, but with this running commentary on
director's comments
on what the relationship between this and that was. So, I mean, so for me now, I think I'm very much, I mean, there's something about, you know, like on that, The Shape of Things Unknown, it's something about this idea that in cinema, well, in certain spaces, there are certain spaces in the society which have been, there are certain kind of interdictions in terms of Black people operating in those spaces. Now, what I've come to believe, I think, is that increasingly, Black people are allowed to operate in certain spaces to a certain degree, as long as they agree, there's a tacit agreement to not reproduce Blackness. Like Obama, for example, that's the classic example of, yeah, you can be president of the United States as long as you don't privilege Black people, you know? So you see this like time and time and time and time again. So whatever it is that I'm doing at any moment, the main thing that I'm mostly preoccupied with is, first of all, expressing myself, meaning AJ, the unquantifiable, kind of all the specifics who I am, a Black guy who grew up in Mississippi at a particular time in between the Delta and, you know, and Tupelo, who went to Howard University, who was attracted, disattracted, that. And like, how do we make things, artifacts? It doesn't matter what they are. You know, I'm always struck by this whole idea that John Coltrane's first artistic ambition was to be a car designer. That was what he wanted to do, is be a car designer. But it wasn't available to him as a Black man at the time. So music, it's like just mind-boggling to me. Like, music was John Coltrane's second choice, you know? But what kind of fucking cars were John Coltrane ever designing? You know? So that's always, it's always like that to me. And I do think there's something very specific, like my friend Fred Moden, he articulated this thing that's in Frank Willison's book, where he says, you know, this idea Harden and Frank Willison had reminded him that we have to remain in the hold, like in the hold of the ship. You know, there's something important about remaining in the hold of the ship, because very paradoxically, in the hold of the ship produces that kind of radical circumscription of your mobility and stuff, produces these imaginative flights. Like, in a sense, here, there is a real ontological sort of framing of who Black Americans are. I mean, we have a very particular kind of expressivity that's completely bound up with being constrained, you know? I was very fascinated in the fine arts context by this whole idea of, you know, early on Cornell, I think it was the first essay I ever read with Cornell, like in the early 90s, and we're asking him about Black culture, and he was talking about all these different things, and then somebody asked him, well, what about Black visual culture? He said, as far as I can tell, it's not that apparent. And it upset a lot of people, like Howard Dean Pendale in particular was very, very upset and felt like he was speaking out of ignorance. He didn't know, you know, the work of Black visual creators and stuff, and he would just speak from ignorance. But his whole thing was, he said, well, I think the reason why is because the Black church is the primary subsidizer of, you know, in terms of sustained subsidy and support of Black expressivity. So you see in the music, oratorical prowess, all these kinds of things, the church provided this foundation for it. But because the Black church was a Protestant church, right, it has this tension-ridden relationship with visualization. So you didn't find in the church the kind of support. Like if you go to Haiti, it's really interesting, like how in Haiti there's this pronounced visual culture that's completely connected to the fact that this is Catholic churches, you know, and the Catholic relationship to iconography and stuff is like completely, totally different. I just think Cornell got it wrong when he said Black visual culture was not that apparent or underdeveloped, because I think what he really should have said is Black pictorial culture is underdeveloped. And it's not underdeveloped for accidental reasons. It's underdeveloped because, first of all, and this is one of my oldest, like the site, Nam June Paik said, the culture that's going to survive in the future is a culture you can carry around in your head. So if you look at Black Americans, we are like a test case of that, because what we're strong culturally, music, oratorical, these kinds of things, that's stuff you can carry on your nervous system. You can't carry architecture, sculptures, all these things that are incredibly rich and diverse in Africa. You can't carry that shit on you with on a slave ship. And even if you could, you know, we were raw material. So we didn't have control of material. So material expressivity, relatively speaking, was underdeveloped. So, as Greg was saying about the music thing is this really privileged space, because something about the immateriality of it and the fact that it could evolve and develop in all of these spaces that we found ourselves, whether it be like a prison, a slave ship, a plantation, a strip joint, all these kinds of places, the music is like paradoxically unleashed. You know, I like to think one of the... Should I keep going like this? And I'm rambling now, but I mean, like, the thing about the music that's so fascinating to me is like, it's paradoxical that in an environment where Black people were so subscribed that the music gets unleashed. And what I mean by that is this. It's like, to me, a little bit like the analogy I've used in the past. It's like when they say HIV, it was a virus that jumped the species barrier, right? It was in monkeys, and once it jumped the species barriers in the human beings, we had no natural protection against it, right? It's kind of like in Mississippi, they brought kazoo into Mississippi to help on erosion in the 20s and 30s. But kazoo, if you're in certain parts of Mississippi, kazoo is over everything, because nothing eats kazoo. See, in that sense, there's no natural predation. So in a sense, in a classical context, the music in Africa, it strikes me, a lot of it is royal music, even though we try to say it's so communal and everybody's making the music and all this kind of stuff. But like if you think of griots and stuff, griots do not sing about the common man, generally speaking, in a classical context. They sing about kings and queens and stuff, right? Black Americans, the folks who are here, we are not, I know we all have the ebony posters and everything, but we are not the descendants of the kings and queens, by and large. We are the descendants of the peasant or the working class. Or generally speaking, we wouldn't have fucking been here in the first place. Because it doesn't make sense if you're buying Black people by the pound, right? But in the natal context, in the original context, you could take a prince and trade them for 200 commoners. It doesn't make sense. It's like selling secretariat for horse meat. You know what I mean? So by and large, we are the descendants of the peasant class. Now, very paradoxically, the music, which mostly spoke the royal class's experiences, by coming on our nervous systems here, you get the combination of two things that produced why Black American music is so powerful. One, it's the oldest musical tradition on the face of the earth. So it's incredibly sophisticated. But it then becomes unhinged from the story of the royal class and becomes the most sophisticated, oldest musical culture in the world. It's telling the story now of the peasant or working class.
And I'm going to cut you right there, because we're going to come back to this, but check it. Because I know you want to show love is the message, right? And that's a perfect...
But the peasant of the working class in the most dramatic circumstances imaginable.
Right. So...
Love is the message.
Yeah, but I also know that, you know, and why I'm making that segue is because you're very much interested in translating the dynamism of the music to this cinema that you want to bring into being. This representation of a Black cinema you want to bring into being. And this piece in some ways represents, again, another intermediary step between this thing that you want to do formally in cinema that you've defined as dynamic Black visual phenomena. And this also, again, represents reference points from the real towards what would become the fictional or the narrative.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So that was good interest.
And she says, call 911. My name was Amanda Berry. I knew something was wrong when a little pretty white girl ran into a black man's arms. Something is wrong here. Dead giveaway. Dead giveaway.
I'm trying to keep my faith.
We on a ultralight beam. We on a ultralight beam. This is a God dream. This is a God dream. This is everything. This is everything.
I'm trying to keep my faith.
Deliver us serenity. Deliver us peace. Deliver us love. You know we need.
The description doesn't fit. If not a synonym or menace, then forget it in turn.
The moment needs you now. Pray for Paris. Pray for the parents. This is a God dream. This is a God dream. This is a God dream. We on a ultralight beam.
We on a ultralight beam. This is a God dream. This is a God dream. This is everything. Everything.
The mundane Afrofuturists recognize that we are not aliens.
Bobby!
Stop here. Stop.
Bobby, wake up!
But I'm looking for more. Deliver us serenity. Deliver us peace. Deliver us love, and we know we need it.
Lord knows we need it.
Oh, put that dick, hit that dick.
You know we need it. You know we need it. The moment needs you now. Oh, man.
Teach me how to plug it, ayy. They be like, smooth.
What?
Can you teach me how to plug it? You know why? Cause all the girls love it.
She said, something ain't right. I said, oh man. She said, oh man, the building is on fire. I got my kids and we bouncing.
This is a God dream. This is a God dream.
I've been dreaming. I've been dreaming.
We on a ultralight beam.
We on a ultralight beam. This is a God dream. This is a God dream. This is everything.
Come on back. Come on back. Keep walking backwards. Keep walking backwards. Put your hands on your head. Right here. Come on back.
What is wrong? We don't have a gun. My kids.
Hold on.
They're 6 and 8. What is going on? Oh my God, you are terrifying my children.
But I'm looking for more. Somewhere I can feel safe. And in my holy war.
And now, Mr. Wallace.
That's just me, the B.I.G. Competition rapper ever since 13.
I'm trying to keep my faith.
Why is it oppression, not blessings? Why oh why do you do me wrong? You persecute the weak because it makes you feel so strong.
What would America be like if we loved black people as much as we love black culture?
For you, I will shield your name. I will field their questions. I will feel your pain. They don't know. They don't know. They don't know.
Foot on the devil's neck to the drifted Pangea. I'm moving all my family from Chatham to Zambia. Treat the D
demons just like Pam. I mean, I fuck with your friends, but damn, Gina, I've been this way since Arthur was anteater. Now they wanna hit me with the woo after bam. Trying to snap photos of family. My daughter look just like Sia, you can't see her. You can feel the lyrics, the spirit coming in braille. Tumming of the underground, come and follow the trail. I made Sunday candy, I'm never going to hell. I met Kanye West, I'm never going to fail. He said let's do a good ass job with Chance 3. I hear you gotta sell it to snatch the Grammy. Let's make it so free and the bar so hard that it ain't one gosh darn part you can't tweet. This is my part, nobody else speak. This is my part, nobody else speak. This little light of mine, glory be to God, yeah. I'ma make sure that they go where they can't go. If they don't wanna ride, I'ma still give them wrangles. Know what God said when he made the first rainbow. Just notice at the end of the fucking lane for the intro. I'm just having fun with it. You know that a nigga was lost. I laugh in my head cause I bet that my ex looking back like a pillow of salt. Cause they put the script on your ass like wrestling is fight. You cannot mess with the light. We on an ultralight beam.
We on an ultralight beam.
This is a God dream.
This is a God dream.
This is everything.
Everything.
But I'm looking for more. Somewhere I can feel. And in my whole
I'm trying to keep my faith. That's what the police do to you.
Father, this prayer's for everyone that feels they're not good enough. This prayer's
put your hands up against the wall.
Too messed up. For everyone that feels they said I'm sorry too many times. You can never go too far when you can't come back home again. That's why I need
So, I actually think now would be a great time to open up the floor.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, so while that's happening, because I know they want to set up mics, when I look at this, I think about Fred Moten's whole statement that we should consider blackness as a critique of the proper, mm-hmm. as also a critique of property ownership or propriety, those kind of things. And I also think of something Amir Baraka said once about, he said, aesthetics and ethics are one. And I'm curious about, in your work, this whole, you know, your consideration of your politics, your aesthetics, your ethics converging, and your sense of the erotic, you know, inside of a work like this.
I mean, sometimes I would start off as say the people, I'm a libertine. But I think, you know, honestly, I say that because it's a way of, in a sense, diverting a certain kind of scrutiny away from what is, to a certain degree, a pathological kind of construct that I think is, like, pretty central to black being. I mean, I used to sometimes, there's a book even in the show that I actually gave a name to the book, which I didn't typically do. There's a book, and I call that book The Abject Sublime, right? And so The Abject Sublime to me is really, it's just basically a codification, this idea that inside of the black worldview, black being, the black continuum, it's impossible to completely separate out what's magnificent about it and what's miserable about it. Like, they're intrinsically bound up. Like Fred has says, he doesn't think like blackness is inherently, you know, horror. Like, horror is not a constituent component of blackness. I may be misquoting him, but I think that's kind of what he said. But, like, I kind of have a slightly different, I guess, opinion about it, because I actually do feel like you know, I used to always pose it in the simplest terms possible. It's like if some supreme being said to you, yo, it's on you. If you want, I can, like, make it so that none of this crazy shit that happened to black people, you know, being brought to the Americas against their will, we're just going to erase that, none of that happened. Well, if you do that, you erase us. We erase. We are erased, right? So it's something about that as a fundamental paradoxical conundrum for black people in the Americas, that our ontological construction is totally bound up with horror. I mean, its inception is bound up with horror. So I think you see that in our most powerful expression. It's always got those things. So, like, to a certain degree, we know if white folks with certain kinds of, like, you know, impulses to save things because they're great, then intervene, half our culture will be gone, because we don't want to look at a lot of this shit, you know? Like my dad, for example, this is a story I guess I could tell in this context. My dad, like, I think my understanding of many of these things is so grounded in the way my father, a Mississippian, viewed the world and the kinds of things that he said. But I remember, like, how he always had this very sophisticated, he would say, like, man, black people, sometimes our stuff is so close, we're so close to it that we almost can't see it. Like, we can feel it, but we can't see it. Or we can see it, but we can't feel it. So a lot of times it takes people from outside of our community to come and take the artifact and make money from it or do certain things with it. Now, so to me, all of my sort of positions about things grow out of that. But then I had this experience with him that was very informative. It was a very, very informative experience. It was like around, I guess it might have been around 2000. My partner Malik was directing this job for Wild Turkey Bourbon. And a producer friend, our friend Melinda, was producing it. And she said, look, okay, it was for Wild Turkey Bourbon. It was coming out of Japan. It was an ad for the Japanese market. And they had this campaign, Wild Turkey the Real Deal. That was what it was, Wild Turkey the Real Deal. And what they wanted was authentic Delta bluesmen, right? So they said, hey, you know, so say, AJ, okay, do you want to work on this? You know, you can do camera, but we also will have you go down and before scout talent, authentic bluesmen, and locations. And we'll pay you to go down and drive around this kind of stuff. So I was like, I think maybe 38, 39. So I was like, okay, this is so cool because now I'm going to do this with my dad, right? And it's going to be great. Me and my dad can go do it together. We can bond, all this kind of stuff. My dad lives in Atlanta. So I fly into Atlanta. We rent a car. We start driving, right? And we drive. And we get to about halfway, which is like Alabama. We're like near Birmingham or something. And I had this book by this photographer named Bernie Eames called Juke Joint. It's like a really incredible book. Photos of interiors of black social spaces in the like early 80s to about the late 80s, maybe the early 90s, right? And a lot of these spaces, because I've actually attempted to go to almost all of the pictures in the book, and the spaces don't exist. They didn't exist 10, 15 years ago, so I'm sure most of them don't exist now. But in any event, it's an incredible, incredible book. I mean, it's like black aesthetics just on display like you've never seen in architectural or spatial. I used to say it's like black feng shui is on display in these books, right? So this book is like a Bible to me, right? This is what I'm going for. This is, and then it also has this other uncanny dimension, meaning like there's no author of it, you know? So it's like unauthored creativity. There's no person who envisioned it. Just kind of happened, as Ismael Marie would say, just grew. So I got this book, you know, and I'm driving, my dad is sitting next to him, and he's playing his Sam Cooke or whatever, and we talking and back and forth. And it occurred to me, oh, I should show him this book, right? This is what we're looking for, right? So I recently, hey, Dad, yo, check this book out. This is it. This is what we're going for right here. So my dad, like, he starts looking through the book. He's, like, totally quiet. He doesn't say anything. He just, page. Then he says, I say, like, amazing, right? My dad looks at me, he says, there's no creativity on display in this book whatsoever. I'm like, man, what are you talking about? This is the most amazing shit ever, right? He said, this ain't no creativity. This is, people ain't got nothing. So I'm like, what? I mean, look, if we start Xing out you know, the stuff we do because it's got an abject quotient, there won't be nothing left. There won't be nothing. Now, this is his same shit he had articulated to me in the music space. But in this other space, he didn't seem to be able to migrate his whole insight, right? The kind of things he had told me. So I'm like, so I started running this thing, da, 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 you know, aesthetics, black sticks. Man, my father got so angry. He started yelling at me while I'm driving, like he was spitting on me. He got so angry that, you know, a person gets so angry that basically, you know, you can't say anything, you can't flinch or anything, because if you flinch the wrong way, they're gonna physically put their hands on you, right? I literally had to roll the window down and put my head out the window and drive the car for about 15, 20 minutes while he talked himself out. Like, I sent you to Howard University for this kind of bullshit? This is why I sent you up here? Come back to me with this kind of shit, right? You know, and I say, look, man, if you got $5 and somebody says decorate your bathroom, one person's gonna take that $5, go to the 10-cent store, get streamers, glitter, and they're gonna do that. Somebody else just gonna drill a hole in the floor and say, take a shit. Both of them are viable, expressive responses to circumstance. Man, when I said that, he went bonkers. He went bonkers, right? So I'm just like, so we don't talk for the next 4 hours. He won't talk to me, right? So I'm just driving, I'm like, this is terrible. This was supposed to be a bonding trip, and this is becoming like, you know, this is like a horrible, this is a nightmare situation, right? So we get to Mississippi, we go through Tupelo, we get down to Clarksville, right? Now, I grew up in Clarksville, but because my extended family was in Tupelo, I don't really go back as much, right? And it's changed a lot, right? They have the Delta Blues Museum, right? So it's on the top of my list. I'm gonna go to the Delta Blues Musician, and that's where I'm just gonna check in and get names, and you know, I'm gonna make these connections, right? So I get the Delta Blues Musician, and wouldn't you know it, they have an exhibition space. What is in the exhibition? Big ass prints from Juke Joint. Massive prints from Juke Joint is the show. So I'm looking at it like, oh, shit. Right? I see my dad walking through the space, looking at the prints, very quietly, standing in front of one, put his head down, go to the next one. Now, I always say that's a point in my life where I knew I had grown up a little bit, because even 2 years before, it would have been impossible for me not to run into space. Next to him, say, ha, is it culture now? Is it culture now? You know? And I didn't say anything. I just let him. I remember just watching him slowly walk through the space and look at these pictures. And it never came up. We never talked about it again in the entire trip. But to me, it was a very informative, like, experience, because I think what it showed is that it was too close for him. It was too close to him. It wasn't like, he couldn't stand back and be ecstatic about it. He couldn't stand back and have this ecstatic position about it because he grew up in those spaces. Like, and he spent his whole life, like, you know, my dad is really into like a carpentry and stuff. And if you looked at my parents' home, it's like some bizarro take on Architectural Digest. Now, anybody who knows Architectural Digest and saw it would be like, this Architectural Digest is kind of insane. Right? You know, it's twisted, it's bent, it's distorted. But for him, that was like him doing this thing that was really like moving away from these spaces that I really think spatially, architectural, sacred spaces. I think they are incredible, like incredibly, there's so much genius on display in these spaces. So anyway, I say all that just to say, we have an aversive like relationship to ourselves. And it's something we have to constantly struggle with, like in our expression and stuff, so.
Yeah, so thank you, man. Yeah, you handled about 8 other questions.
Okay.
That one response, man, thank you.
It's gotta be some questions.
The floor is open to you guys. So I know they want you to take advantage of the mics so we can record and stream everything. So.
Okay, I didn't want to be first, but that's okay. Thank you for sharing your work, and thank you especially for us sharing your stories. Okay, I want to get right into it too. So I think at the beginning, they mentioned like the space between pain and beauty. And then you mentioned horror in terms of talking about how Black people are experienced and experience the world, I wanted to add something else to that tension. When I was watching your work, I could see just the thread that ran through it for me is tension. And so I think if we're talking about, and this is, I know, a very hot button issue for most Black people right now, white people imitating the culture as they see fit, I think that the element that they miss and what makes it most inauthentic, it's inauthentic just by its very nature, but most inauthentic is because they miss that element of tension. So I want to thank you for telling me the Coltrane story, because I didn't know that he wanted to be a car designer. But when I think about, when I listen to Coltrane for like days on end, which I often do, there's something I'm trying to hear or discern between the notes, and now you show me what it is. It's that tension and that denial of what you want to, how you see yourself versus what you're forced to settle for. And I think that all the snippets that you picked in your work show that same tension, that same denial, and that same suppression. And I think people, Lord, I'm trying to bring this into focus. So I guess if you could just comment on if, one, you see that tension, and if it runs a thread through pretty much all all the snippets that you used. And I noticed you used some of Khalil Joseph's piece from his installation. I'm really glad you did that, because I think that's an excellent example of what I'm talking about, and I think can be missed. They can just see the imagery and the grittiness of it, but not the tension and how that affects everything that we are and everything that we create, and it is inextricable from everything that we are and everything we create.
Well, I could. There's a lot I could say. Well, I'll just start off in one place. You know, again, right on. It's funny, the Elvis Presley thing, just on the level of quote unquote imitation or appropriation or whatever. If our shit is the baddest shit, like we say it's the baddest shit, then people should be trying to imitate it. That's one. We can't have it both ways. We can't say our shit is the baddest shit and not expect people to imitate it. It's supposed to be imitated, right, so to speak. Also, too, there's a really complicated philosophical discussion about where's the boundaries between I and we and you and me. Like, in other words, if I imitate Little Richard, yeah, I can say I'm Black, so I have more right to do it, but, like, on a certain level, I'm not related to Little Richard. You see what I'm saying? It's complicated. I used to say all the time, like, we shouldn't, as Black folks, we shouldn't deny Elvis Presley. I'm not saying this is what you're saying or maybe implying, but we shouldn't deny Elvis Presley's creativity because in a white supremacist context, his creativity is being elevated above, you know, his contemporaries, Little Richard, Bo Diddley, Chuck Berry, you know what I mean? We should just say, okay, because Elvis Presley is super creative. He's super creative. I mean, especially early on. It's just fly, you know, fly, the way he moved and all this kind of stuff. Could it exist without Little Richard and these people? No, but they couldn't exist without the people that influenced them. That's always the case. That's always a given. So, to me, ultimately, like, even, yeah, tension, right, absolutely. Like, there's a term I use a lot called Black potential. And to me, Black potential, what that is the inherent tension between actualized and unactualized Black expressivity or Black endeavor. Meaning, it's not just that human beings, we're born into this life, we have ambitions, we try to, you know, achieve those ambitions, we fail or succeed to whatever degree we do. But in the context of Black life, there's this other dimension around not being able to realize your potentiality. People see it all the time, right? So it's not just succeed or don't succeed. Like, I know, like, increasingly, like, I've spent a lot of energy in the last 18 months discussing with my circle, which Khalil is part of, which Malik is part of, which Elisa Moorhead, our partner in Teenage, is part of. We have a lot of discussions around, like, you know, it's very human to say, I want to be there. I want to be in the Olympics. But only a few people get there. That's human. You try to do it, you get there, you don't get there. But it's so there's a split between the people who do get there and the people who don't. But for inside a black being, there's this thing that's like, okay, if you take black cinema, like a person made a film and it's great just because it got made. You know what I mean? Because we know this whole issue against actualization. But if you just make a film, does that make it a great film? Does that make it a black film? What is a black film? Like, there are films that are more useful for me that are failures than films that are successful. I won't mention no names because I ain't trying to get into trouble, right? But you know, there are films that succeed, but they succeed in terms that I don't think move the black cinema question forward, right? They don't fail at trying to do something new. They just try to be at best, like, you know, I've said before, like, if you know Jesse Norman or Leontine Price or any black person that's in opera or something, if you know opera well enough, you could probably even make a case that they bring a black sensibility to what they do, but that's not black music. Even if they're singing about Egyptians, like in Aida, it's not black music, right? So when you hear Jesse Norman, it could be genius. I'm not trying to diminish what it is, but I'm saying for myself and for this whole question of how do we actualize certain kinds of possibilities, when I look at Aretha Franklin, I see something else. Because I don't just see her individual genius, right, which is clearly everybody. I also see that she's working in a form that collectively evolved in response to the pressure we put on music to express what it is we feel existentially. You know what I'm saying? So the terms are not even there. We force terms into being because we're trying to do that. Now, cinema, like architecture to a certain degree, fine arts maybe to a lesser degree, these are spaces black people haven't been allowed, by and large, to play in. That's the main thing. How do you play? How do we make space where we can play? Not just do it, not just be in it, but actually play, meaning like you can do something and it's not life or death. Like, you know, your thing being good or not being good is not the difference between your quality of life from one moment to the other, you know? We have to create those spaces. Like I told someone the other day, like when we had to open and everything, I was like super anxious at the opening. And I was like, I never really did good in like the art openings and stuff. And I said, I realized like for me, or this is at least how I'm articulating it now, it's because I don't think art has any inherent value. I think art, fine arts, quote unquote fine arts, all the value is assigned value. There's nothing wrong with that, but it's not like a lump of coal. You can heat it, it'll make heat. Firewood, you can do this. Water, you can drink. Some things have real, like actual real value. But art is like you can shit in the can, quite literally. And if everybody collectively agree, it's a masterpiece, right? I mean, I'm not saying literally. This is literally the truth. So like to me, the art world is like being a figure skater as opposed to a sprinter. Jesse Owens could go to the Olympics and win in front of the Nazis because it's cut and dry. You either got there to the line first or you didn't. There's no interpretation or very little space for interpretation. Figure skating, black people will never do well in figure skating. Yeah. I don't care. You can do a triple somersault and levitate off the ice and you will get an 8.5, right? Like that sister from France, what was her name? Suri something. That sister was incredible. We don't like the way her body looks. What can she do with that? This how come we have like Michael Jackson and people, shapeshifters, morphing their bodies and stuff? Because it's trying to contend with that, which you can't contend with. I can just do the move, but I can't change the shape of my body, right? So the art world is like figure skating to me. It's too much interpretation, right? And so when I go into the space, I feel completely exposed to other people's opinions about what I do. Because films, whether they're good or bad, I have some sense of if it's working. I used to say it's like Mount Fuji. Mount Fuji exists. It don't care whether you like it or not. You could like it or don't like it. Want to see it or don't want to see it. It still is. Film to me is more like that. I can say, for me internally, this film is working. This thing I made here is working. You may not like it, you may not. In the art world, it's a shell game. So when I go in there and I say, I feel good about this. I told somebody, I don't know if I'd be more troubled by 1,000 white folks coming to me and say they loved what I did or they hated what I did. I don't know which one is more troubling. Anyway. So I don't know if I answered your question. So.
Just to clarify the format, the mic will be coming to you. Phil Donahue style. So anyone else?
I'm still trying to form my question, so forgive me if it's not like straight to the point.
Take your time.
But I do agree and have feelings about what you just said is like, what is that fear of like them coming to you and saying they don't like it versus like them coming to you and saying that they do like it. And I guess one of my questions is that it's just like, does it really matter what they have to say? Because ultimately, are you making it for them? Or are you making it for yourself and your people? But I guess my real question is that you said that we shouldn't be upset when they take from us, that if our shit's that hot, like we need to expect it. And I think a lot of Black people, depending on what their development and access to shit socially to like grow and actually see the truth of that, it's not that. It's that, yeah, our shit's hot. We know that. We expect people to be attracted to it. We have no problem with people being attracted to it and working through it. We actually share a lot of our shit with people, which is part of the issue with why it gets taken from us. But this thing that, what is it that white people are actualizing when they take our shit? Like, I think that is the issue that Black people are actually upset with and that a lot of them don't know how to vocalize. Is what actually, not what are we actualizing or can't actualize, but what are white people actualizing when they take our shit because it's so hot? Because 9 times out of 10, it's not that they're humanizing us more. It's typically that they're mocking us. In an example of something like Iggy Azalea and Post Malone, two tired ass white people whose careers didn't take off until they started mocking us. So what is your opinion, I guess, more so in this thing of like, what are white people actually actualizing? What are white people actualizing when they come up to you and tell you whether or not they like or don't like your work?
Well, I mean, the truth of the matter is my experience of the art world has, I say what I said to kind of make a point. I never know what people think, honestly. People don't really come up. I feel like there's relatively little feedback for me in the art world. So I put that out there in the beginning. Let's just take Iggy Azalea.
Are you familiar with Post Malone?
Oh, yeah.
Talk about him
instead
so we can avoid
him. Oh, really? I don't know about that. Yeah, I mean, I'm just speaking for myself now. I don't know. I'm going to resist that a little bit. I'm going to talk about both of them. And I think I can do it, hopefully, without being a misogynist. I'm going to try. In both instances, I mean, Post Malone feels, first of all, more authentically part of the culture than Iggy Azalea does. That might just be simply because he's from here and she's not from here. I never been one to be like, on a certain level, I don't care. It's very mediocre. I find what she does very mediocre. Yeah, but I guess what I'm trying to get at is like in music in particular, Black people have so much force. We have so much cultural confidence in music. Like, yeah, we could take up the issue of like who's being like successful and why they're being successful. But I guess there's so much incredible stuff that Black people do in music that it just seems to me like I wouldn't even expend any energy on thinking about what Iggy Azalea does. The thing is just so not elevated. I actually think Post Malone musically is way more interesting. You know what I mean? Is he more successful than a Black person of relatively the same level of talent? I don't know, maybe. But he's not more successful than Young Thug, and he's not as interesting as Young Thug, and never will be in this lifetime.
But within that though, the nigga that's on his same level ain't gonna get it to like, is like Post Malone exists in the same breath
Post Malone exists in the same breath that Young Thug does. The fact that your brain connects the two of them to mention them together, not comparatively, but that Young Thug is this thing that exists that I can mention. Whereas, can you name a black rapper, whether they be male or female, that you can compare to Post Malone? Like, that's what I'm saying. So what are white people actualizing when they take our shit? Because they're dehumanizing us. But what furthermore are they like, what is that actualization?
I guess what I was trying to problematize in the beginning is that if you are moved as a human being now, not to descend to the level of human beings, but if you are moved by something as a human being and you choose to imitate it, operate in that mode or whatever, that's just the nature of human folks. What problematizes it is white supremacy, right? That's what problematizes it. White supremacy is the environment's happening. But the impulse is a natural impulse. So on some level, we have to have the capacity to tease those things out when we see this. Meaning, that's why I was saying, let's be clear. Let's critique the system that elevates Elvis above people of relative talent. Let's critique it. But at the end of the day, Elvis did some fresh shit with it, right? I think Post Malone, you know, that song is like that one song, like White Iverson. That song is kind of bonkers in a way. You know, I kind of appreciate it on the levels like, wow, it's crazy. This guy says I'm like Iverson, you know what I mean? That's such a Dadaist statement. I'm a White Iverson. I don't even know what the fuck that means, man. It's like, it's actually interesting. You know what I mean? It's interesting. It's funny. It's like, it's funny. It's like, I think in this time-space continuum, our challenge, my challenge, and the challenge of people who I think who are trying to move in a certain kind of way is to see all of this stuff, see all of that stuff, like, oh, relative this and that, but still smash what we're doing. See, this is my thing. Ultimately, I'm a race man at the end of the day. And I believe that oldest thing, you got to be twice as better. I believe that, right? I see black people operating in these spaces, whether it be sports or things like that, and we know we can transform these spaces. But if we transform these spaces, it's only logical. It's not like when I hear sometimes, like, you know, black folks, you know, black people are the originators of civilization, right? We're the first civilization. Yeah, that's true. But that means, well, the first rape, pillage, imperialism, all those other things, we're the originators of that too. You can't have it both ways.
I don't think that we're trying to have it both.
I honestly don't think niggas are trying to have it both ways. I think what it is that within this regard of...
What's up with that?
What's up with what? I'm asking my question. Shh, please. I don't think it's my word. It's my word. Do you want to have that conversation right now? Or do you want to have a conversation about you interrupting my question while I'm talking to him? I think you can be quiet for a second. Thank you. It's okay, so someone else can ask a question. I have no problem with that. Do you have a question that you want to ask?
Okay.
Woosah. So I just want to say thank you for being here and for...
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, and being insightful. But I guess, on this whole, question of representation and, the use of the N-word and all the conflict. What I'm gathering from what you're saying is that it's really about us, and I would like for you just to maybe just talk more about that without interruption about, it's okay that other people do whatever they're doing, but what are we doing? And I think it's just, I'm gathering that from what you were saying. I just want you to continue to talk about that. I think it's important.
Let me do this for a second, because let's just in the interest of timing, let's grab some more questions out of the air, and we'll respond to, maybe a couple of things at the same time.
Some more questions?
Yeah. Yes, brother here. And then if someone had hand up back here at one point, I thought, yeah.
How you doing today, good brother? My name is David McDuffie, traveling photographer by way of Chicago, Illinois, out of...
on a motorcycle.
Yes, sir. And a fellow Howard Bison as well. H-U? So this question is kind of... my foot is in two places in time and space with this question. But you mentioned how blacks here, how our existence is linked to slavery, and you also spoke about how music is something that was transmitted through the nervous system across through civilization through centuries up until this point in time, and you also spoke about it being linked to singing for the king, right? When you said that, I thought about the connection between Hebrew slavery in the Delta in Egypt and then slavery here in the U.S., and just the kind of request for song for the king. Could you speak about the possible link between the two from and within the Delta region as well, from Egypt to the U.S., if there's any type of connection you feel there, and also the concept of... I would say divine providence in Edward Blyden's words about blacks in the U.S. being brought here during slavery for a purpose, almost in the same way that manifest destiny is talked about by whites with America's expansion.
Yeah. Well, let's grab one more.
Really?
Yeah, sure. you play three-dimensional chess, brother. I know, you know.
This is like multi-dimensional chess. It's like,
let's just one more. Let's see. All right.
Man, I don't have the same amount of brain cells I used to if I can hold on to all these questions.
Well, I'll ask a really simple question. First of all, thank you so much for the conversation. But I noticed President Obama in the second piece that you showed singing Amazing
Grace. In tune.
He's in tune. But just thinking about tension, possibilities, constraints, all of these things that kind of lay the conditions of possibility and impossibility for black people in a variety of different endeavors and expressions. What symbolically, as we approach in however many months a post-Obama era, what has Obama meant for possibility, impossibility? How has Obama symbolized new avenues of possibility or not? Or how do you position him and what he has represented over almost this past decade with all the different contradictions we've seen unspool in the media and in our lives? How would you take stock of his representational force in music, in film, in whatever medium you would choose? What kind of stories would come forth through you with Obama as sort of a prismatic focal point?
Okay, so you wanted, if I recall correctly, you wanted to talk about our responsibility as creators in this moment. So brother, you wanted to talk about the tragedy of our...
Israelites!
Yeah, you know what I mean? Exportation to the Americas, and look at that as possibility and prophecy. And then there's the Obama question.
I mean, let me go backwards, man. Okay. I mean, honestly, Chris, I don't really think about Obama that deep. I mean, I think, like, to me, I have two things about it. One, I think it's really important for us to, or for me, I try to work to stay in touch with his election, meaning, which is separate from his presidency. I think the election was some genius jazz shit, the way they pull that shit off. I never thought I would see that in my life. I mean, honestly. So I try to stay close to that sense that I had that was an impossibility. It was literally impossible for a black person to be president. And now it's 8 years ago, right? My son doesn't know anything but a black guy being president, okay? So I try to stay close to that. Like, you know, all the other stuff about, you know, good, like I said in the beginning, I feel like white, you know, black folks we can always be in positions of authority inside of the system as long as we don't reproduce blackness and we reproduce whiteness in various forms or shapes. So he's a good example of that. The other thing I would say about it is, like, I think people have different opinions about his presidency and stuff like that, but I would hope, if nothing else, it would disabuse us of a kind of very surfacey kind of identification with people based on the fact that they're black. You know, in other words, a black person, in a simple-minded kind of Cartesian thing, a black person in office is going to be better for black people. But we know from Clarence Thomas, that's not true, right? Because this shit is complicated and it's not linear like that. The good guys don't wear the, you know, some of the best guys wear black hats or whatever. You know what I'm saying? It's not that. I think that's a fiction that we have to kind of, we have to outgrow collectively now. We need to outgrow it collectively now. So that's all I would say on the Obama thing. I mean, if he hadn't have been in tune, I wouldn't have used it. You know, honestly, it wasn't like Obama got to impose himself on the thing. I just thought, I'm going to tell you the best thing about it. And this has nothing to do with him being a president. I mean, it's connected because he is the president. But the flyest thing about it is, like, when he sings Amazing Grace, he turns and looks behind him like, niggas, y'all can't believe this, can you? He got this look on his face like, I'm about to go here. I always imagine when he got home that night, Michelle said, please, I can't believe you did that. That was kind of gangster. You know what I mean? I mean, the way people, they look like they woke up. The guy's behind, there's a guy behind, he goes like this. And he stands up and starts clapping, you know? So it's a kind of audaciousness of him singing Amazing Grace. That's the flyest part about it. But, you know, he has those moments, and I like that. I like, that's it, like, when he first got elected, like, in the very first day he was elected, there was a shot of him walking into the White House, and he just had this walk. That's, you know, hey, give him credit. It was fly. You know, it was fly. But whether he's a good president or not, I don't know. this brother here, see, Hortense, those kind of questions.
Hortense Spillers.
Yeah. Hortense Spillers. Those kind of questions are almost impossible, hard to answer. I think when I, in my another film I did, Hortense Spillers is in it. She says a lot of deep shit in it, right? But at a certain point, I just asked her, I said, why do we end up here? You know, why do we end up in the situation that we're in, this existential, mythic circumstances black people find themselves in? And she said, well, I can only answer that poetically, you know? And basically what she then proceeded to do was to drop this theory that, in fact, she said, the whole thing about the slavery question for black people in America is that it's got conflated. Two things have gotten conflated. She says, basically, the fundamental problem is an essentially intramural problem between Africans and black people in America, right? Meaning, she says, she feels like there's a thesis that says the ruling class in Africa, right? Older civilization, ruling class in Africa was dealing with rebellious anarchic energy, right? And they used the slave trade to vent that energy. Meaning, they were complicit in the slave trade and they use it the way people talk about how England emptied its prisons and that's where Australia came from. She says, basically, there's a thesis that says there was all of this, because if you've been to Africa, I don't know if you have or not, one of the first things you figure out, man, these are some old, rigid societies. You can feel it. You can feel how deep it is. And Benin, which I love, but it's like the layers of it. It's so deep, man, right? It's like rigid, like just, you know, it's like not a lot of movement. Like it may be relative to another society. It may seem like it's all improvisatory, but at the same time, everybody's in their place, right? So this whole idea, I think, was like a fascinating idea to me. But I think the ultimate thing is about reading. So if I say, you know, we were not the kings and queens, I mean, in a certain level, that's like an overdetermined statement. I'm saying it to make a point, you know what I mean? And I think there's a certain poetic truth in it. I think to extend the idea, and this is a reading, you know, it's a creative misreading in a certain way of our circumstances. I would say, if it's true that there was this anarchic energy that got dispersed here, that explains a lot about our temperament, right? One of the things I noticed when I went to Mali the first time, I was reading this book called by Susan Barrett Smith called Bamana and the Making of Bamana Sculpture. It's a really amazing book because it's one of the books that gets into the mindset of the people who are making the shit, right? And one of the things that she says in the book that's really deep, she says, she breaks this thing down. She says, look, in a lot of like classical African societies, they have an equivalent of this. But for the Bamana, they have this term called Nyama. Nyama is just life force, right? All living beings have it, life force. You come here with it, you accrue it or diminish it in your life, and then you know, go to the afterlife and you get some more of it, right? Now, in classic Bamana culture, they believe that human beings are born with Nyama, an excess of Nyama, and that Nyama has to be shaped. It has to be trimmed. It's like your fro. It's got to be trimmed in order for it to be social. It can't just grow wild, right? They believe that if you are not subjected to the various techniques they have, initiation and stuff like this, you could never be a productive member of society, right? It doesn't matter how old you are, how wise you are, you will never on a spiritual level be a productive member of society. So they have all these mechanisms to shape your Nyama, your life force right now. They believe this so strongly because they think like older people and younger people have the most Nyama. Younger people because they're just coming from the afterlife, pre-life, right? And older people because they're getting close to it again. They have more of it, right? But they believe this so strongly that they felt like if an uninitiated person engendered another person with Nyama, that they had no mechanism to recuperate that person as a productive member of society. In other words, if a young lady who had not yet been initiated got pregnant and had a child, classically what they would do is take that child and leave it in the woods to die. Because they felt like that child was going to be a chaotic force in life. They had no social mechanism to make that child productive. They had to just send that child back to the afterworld, right? Now, if that's true, and true or not, if they believe this, and we're talking about believe this on some deep psychoanalytical levels from thousands of years back. If they believe this, if they believe that a child born to an uninitiated young woman is unrecuperable, is in fact a monster, what do they see when they look at us? See what I'm saying? How many generations are we, the uninitiated, engendering the uninitiated, engendering the uninitiated, right? So we are monsters. Even if they don't intellectually believe it, on some sort of psychoanalytical level, they believe that. Maybe that's also an explanation for we were talking about the tension and the creativity and all that stuff because it's an excess of Nyama, right? You know, our creativity is, everybody knows it's true, but people have different relationships to it. Some people want to, you know, capitalize on it. Some people want to suppress it. Some people want to destroy it. But everybody knows, like, you know, a black person dancing, that's just like, it's the most amazing thing on the face. Everybody knows it. It don't mean anything beyond that, right? So I think like with Hortense's reading about this whole thing of they were using it to vent, right? This rebellious energy or the whole idea that in the classic mind, I'm gonna think, we have to begin to try to unpack all these kinds of things. You see what I'm saying? It's ultimately not whether it's true. It's not a true or not true. It's like, how do we frame, as she said, a poetic response? How do we frame our circumstances in the most productive way, in the way that's going to elicit the most emancipatory possibilities for us on the collective level and on the individual level? Okay, and what was the...
I think you answered the question about our responsibility as creators there. I felt, yeah, right? Okay. That might be the game, set, match, drop the mic moment, but if anybody has a burning last question, we could take it. Mr. Caldwell
got a question.
I'll give it up for Mr. Caldwell.
It can be two. You ask him.
Okay, what about in relationship?
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Yeah.
What about in relationship to Stuart Hall and visual images forming opinions in consciousness about defining subjectivity, defining how dominant culture uses images? And so pictures, all sorts of items to define subjects such as ourselves. And so we have the agency to introduce counter narratives, to introduce other signs. I think now we're talking fine art.
Yeah, I agree with that.
All right. Lump of coal?
Huh? What now? I'm sorry.
No, he's saying it's equivalent. Is it equivalent to a lump of coal?
Because this is consciousness now. It's not warmth, but it's consciousness.
I mean, this is why I'm engaged with it, even though I don't think it has any inherent value. I think the issue, in fact, is how do we assert value? It's not the thing in itself. It's like, somebody told me the other day, Jeff Donaldson said, Malik was saying this the other day, that he said the first thing he remembers from this class about African art was he says, you can never see anything in African art not in context. So when you see the mask, yeah, we could talk about it in formal terms, but somebody wore that thing. That thing was part of a masquerade. It was part of a ritual. So it's kind of like that. It's like, again, what I was trying to say, like, I love Oscar Michaud. A lot of people maybe, I don't know, people know who Oscar Michaud is? So I'm like, okay, that's great. Like 10 years ago, people wouldn't know who Oscar Michaud was, right? When I was in school, the first time I ever saw Oscar Michaud film at Howard University, a professor Myers prefaced showing it to me by saying, now I'm going to show you how not to make a film. That's how he introduced it, right? So I'm looking at it like saying, okay, this is probably some booty shit, right? And I'm looking at it, I'm thinking like, within 15, 20 minutes, I'm like, this shit is kind of interesting, man, right? I thought it was a perfect example of using a negative assessment. Like, in other words, it's like trying to judge Bob Dylan by the criteria that you would say James Brown was excellent, or vice versa. It's pointless, you see what I'm saying? So, like, for me, the thing has always been about, like, with Michaud, my thing is this. Like, Jay Holman, he had this interesting thing. He said, if Ed Woods were the worst filmmaker of all time, Oscar Michaud was the baddest. And I have this kind of mantra. If we do it once, it's an accident. If we do it twice, it's a coincidence. But the third time, it's culture, right? So in his stuff, even the supposedly mistakes, this dude made like almost 30 feature films. Even the supposedly mistakes are dope. If we say it's dope. If we imitate it, if we say, when he did that cut, which was bad by Hollywood spatial continuity, if we replicate that cut and that becomes part and parcel of our spatial continuity in our cinema, that makes it dope. Because we picked it up and we extended it, right? And since I believe, as a black filmmaker who was not only genius, meaning Michaud, but was operating at a point when all the Hollywood forms and protocols and stuff were not hegemonic. They weren't so dominant and calcified as they are now. He operated, and he had more free space to operate. So I think him, Spencer Williams, those people who made a lot of films then, it's important for us to study what they did, because in some ways the natural impulses of black Americans will be latently inscribed in that stuff. And so the thing is, like, how do we extract those implications and expand on them or build on them? If that makes sense. Dr. Caldwell.
Yeah. Thank you for the journey. It's been fun. But I wanted to talk about Ed Bland.
Ed Bland.
And the cry of jazz, since we just lost the brother. But this conversation is kind of reminding me of him and the cry of jazz, you know. I just thought that would be a good one to drop in your brain.
Okay, yeah, for sure. Ed Bland, people know who Ed Bland is? He made this film called The Cry of Jazz in 1959.
On YouTube.
It's on YouTube now. It's the only film he finished. He made this one film. It's a really amazing film. And 1959 is a bit of a dead spot in terms of the history of black independent film, like black people making films, independent-minded films. Because Michaud's last film, I think, is 48. And then there's a big period where you don't, until early 60s, you start to see more black independent film. But Ed Bland makes this really amazing film called The Cry of Jazz that just formally it really does so many things that I think are just part of our aesthetic, right?
Yeah. It's sort of a Sunrise Orchestra.
Exactly. Sort of a narrative, sort of a document. It's like it exists across all these sort of boundaries of what a movie is, right? And at the same time, it's a visual essay about the things that it's actually implementing formally. Like, that's what I would say is really, really dope about Ed Land. Beyond that, he was a really interesting brother. And when I met him here, he just dropped so much. Golly, man, he gave me an audio tape of early Duke Ellington. And he had this whole analysis of Duke Ellington in his black and tan period and just how Ellington took the whole jungle music thing to a certain place, but just strategically realized, I'm gonna explore these other things now, because he felt like there wasn't gonna be a certain reception. But it's just, I'm just saying, Ed, like, in a lot of ways, shaped a lot of my thinking about black cinema. And plus, on top of it, he wrote the dopest, like, it's the model, in a sense. He wrote a film, he did the film, and then he had this thing, like, he wrote in film, I think it was a film journal, like in 1960, where he just says, the acting is not good in my film, given. So-and-so is not good, given. He just, you know, and then he went on to say, but so-and-so, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm doing that. I always thought, like, that's the classic way that we should contextualize or contain or frame our cinema ourselves, you know what I mean? So it's like the other day, like, we were talking just the other day at the opening and stuff, and I said to Saul Williams, I was telling him about Ben, I didn't embarrass him a little bit, but I was saying, like, my whole thing with pictures and the way I've started to use pictures in, like, an Apex or something, is very much grounded in this film that Ben did called I and I, that just sort of blew my mind when I was a sophomore at Howard. Like, he was coming in for a job talk. And, like, in a way, I mean, I think I'm doing my own thing with it, but, like, in a way, quite literally, all I did was took what he did and extended it, right? Now, whether I was caught up in the rapture of what he did, or I just decided, like, yo, I like this brother, I think his film is fresh, I'm going to extend what he did. That's how culture gets made, right? By creating continuity between a person that's creative here and a person that's creative there. You know, it's no, like, so much stuff that gets to be the foundations of things, it's just totally arbitrary. It's simply that somebody else said, oh, when that person made that move, that was kind of fly. So I'm going to do a kind of fly thing. And then somebody else saw it and did a bad version of it. And somebody saw it and said, that was fly. You know? And you just keep repeating that pattern over and over. So that's, like, in other words, the whole point I'm trying to make with this ramble is I'm less interested in the Oscar Michaud, the historical Oscar Michaud, and I'm more interested in the Oscar Michaud that we actively imagine. Right? That we invent the Oscar Michaud that we want. And so if I say Oscar Michaud is our Louis Armstrong, I make that be by me picking up things that may be accidental, arbitrary, doesn't really matter. I take things in his work and I fold those things into my work. And when I do that, it can't be questioned, because it is. Can I show one more thing? Oh, no. I just want to show one last thing as you guys walk out or whatnot. It's real short. I want to show the walks. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Sorry, guys.
And then we'll do the reverse funkadelic and take it off the stage.
Yeah. I mean, just because I think I showed you, like, hard things. Like, hard things. I think we were always so hard. But I have a lot of love in my heart.
I knew you were going to go do that LL space. I need
love. Okay, lights, too.
is here, and love will last. Your body's warm and sure to please, lady of love. Take all of me. Every day I dream of holding you close to me. Every night I find me touching your lips with mine. No, oh.
Rastafari.
Thank you.